Well, good morning, everyone. It's good to see you here today at Midway. Let's stand together, and we're going to sing together as we open up the service. Love Lifted Me, hymn 138, if you want to follow along in your hymn book there. Hymn 138, Love Lifted Me. I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, seeking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Let you do something a little fun, right? We like to enjoy ourselves when we're at church. And so today, let's get the blood flowing a little bit this morning, get our juices going here, get excited and get moving here this morning. You're going to get to join, and this is an interactive song. This is not just a standstill kind of song. So here's what we're going to do. When we get to that chorus and we sing, Love Lifted Me, it's very simple. You don't have to be a well-trained yoga instructor to do this. You don't have to be very flexible to do this. This is very easy. All you have to do is stand on your tiptoes. That's all you got to do. Love lifted me. All right? So why don't we try it together one time, all right? Love lifted me. All right, you can do better than that. I mean, come on. Some of you guys act like you're frail and worn out. So let's, when we get to the chorus, let's do it together, all right? All my heart to Him I give, ever to Him I'll cling. In His blessed presence live, ever His praises sing. Love so mighty and so true merits my soul's best song. Faithful, loving service who to Him belongs. Love lifted me, love lifted me. There you go. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Now watch me on this last chorus when we sing together, okay? Let's sing the third verse up. Souls in danger, look above. Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by His love out of the angry waves. He's a master of the sea. Will obey. He, your Savior, wants to be saved today. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me. Love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted. Come on, you can do it. Lifted me. Anybody else out of breath after that one? I'm a little tired after that one. All right. We better pray and take a moment of introspection here this morning. It's good to see you here today at Midway. I would ask for your prayers this morning. My daughter's homesick, and so we're down a pastor's wife here today. I was telling Sid before the service, one half of my brain is gone this morning, so we're going to muscle through it, though, today. But I'd appreciate your prayers for my daughter. She's just a little under the weather here today, but I know many are, and it seems like a lot of sickness is getting ramped up. So let's be in prayer for one another as we think about each other's needs. Why don't we pause and pray right now, and we'll ask God to bless this service and bless our church family here today. Brother Marty Brundage, would you open us, sir? Amen. All right, now, hymn 477, as we continue to sing together, He Keeps Me Singing, hymn 477. Aren't you glad for a Lord that puts a new song in your heart? Hymn 477, He Keeps Me Singing. There's within my heart a melody, Jesus whispers sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee, peace be still, in all of life's ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Singing as I go, soon He's coming back to welcome me far beyond the starry sky. I shall wing my flight to worlds unknown. I shall reign with Him on high. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know, fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I go. Now another song that you're very familiar with, there is a Redeemer sent from heaven. So let's sing this song together. We normally sing this at Christmas time, but this is a great song any time of the year as we think about Jesus Christ and His life here. There is a Redeemer. There is a Redeemer, Jesus, God's own Son, precious Lamb of God, Messiah, Holy One. Thank you, O my Father, for giving us your Son. Lift our voices as the instrument as we sing to the Lord this morning. Thank you, O my Father, for giving us your Son and leaving your Spirit till the work on earth is done. Now, hymn 46, as we finish up our singing time this morning, hymn 46, crown Him with many crowns. There is a Redeemer, and because we have a Redeemer, He's worthy of all that we can offer Him. So crown Him with many crowns.
Crown Him with many crowns, the Lamb upon His throne. Hail Him. inside, rich wounds yet visible above, in beauty glorified. No angel in the sky can fully bear that sight, but downward bends his wandering eye at mystery so bright. Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave and rose victorious to the strife for those he came to save.
Singing. You can be seated there this morning. We're going to dismiss our kids for children's church at this point. Sixth grade and under, you're welcome to step out and join Brother Mike for your lesson this morning there in children's church. The rest of us here in the auditorium, let's turn together to John 15. John chapter 15. John chapter 15 together, and we're going to continue and really finish out today our study on the vine and branches. We're going to transition to something else next week, but we're going to close out our study here in John 15 with a message that I hope will be helpful to you, especially you parents of teenagers here today. I want to share some things with you about some upcoming events, and I just want you to get involved and be a part of what God's going to do in their hearts this summer. But John 15 and verse number 16, if you'll go there with me, John chapter 15 and verse number 16. We will read this together, verse number 16, then we'll jump down to verse number 18. John 15, verse 16. The Bible says, "Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you, that ye should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it you. These things I command you, that ye love one another. If the world hate you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. If ye were of the world, the world would love his own. But because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. Remember the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also. But all these things will they do unto you for my name's sake, because they know not him that sent me." And so we've been talking about over the past several weeks, many weeks now, about this idea of the vine and the branches, that as believers are to be connected to Christ, and not just connected, but confidently connected to Jesus Christ. We are to abide in him, he says. And so we've been talking about those three different categories of this idea, these three topics that Jesus has been discussing in John chapter 15, that we are to abide, we're to abound, and we're to spread abroad. So abide, abound, and abroad. And now we come to our final part of this series. Now, of course, there's so much more that we could talk about out of John 15. This is a rich passage of Scripture, and I encourage you to take time and go back and study this for yourself and see what God has for you in this passage as well. But as a church, we're going to close out this study together in this idea of spreading abroad with this concept. We need to spread the gospel. Spreading the gospel. So let's pray together, and we're going to ask God to help us as we study. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for your word. Thank you that what we're viewing today are the words of Jesus Christ for our hearts today. These words were spoken to disciples, his followers, 2,000 years ago. But Lord, as we read these words today, we recognize that they were spoken to them, but they were also spoken for us. And they are here to help us and encourage our hearts today, to give us guidance on how to live this life, commands to follow so that we can live for you and we can enjoy life in a greater way than we ever thought possible. Lord, I pray that you would be lifted up today, that you would be pleased, with the message this morning. Lord, I trust that you will speak to our hearts. Lord, if there's somebody here today who's struggling in their hearts, maybe with the ideas of eternity and heaven and hell, Lord, I pray you'd speak to them. I pray your Holy Spirit would work in their hearts today. Lord, maybe there's a believer today who needs your encouragement from your word. He needs a push from the Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray that you would give him that nudge by your Spirit. Or maybe there's somebody here today who needs to be convicted of sin. And Lord, certainly we all have things in our lives that we struggle with, besetting sins. Lord, if there's someone today who's struggling, I pray that you'd speak to them and give them your help and your encouragement and your conviction today from your word. And Lord, maybe there's somebody here today that's in a special situation. You've been working on their hearts to serve you with their lives. Lord, I pray that you'd speak to them today. Show them the importance of spreading the gospel, and Lord, that maybe they have a part to play in that in their very lives in a bigger way, in a broader way than they've ever thought possible. Lord, maybe there's somebody you're calling today to serve. I pray that you'd speak to them today. Lord, use this message. Hide me behind the cross of Christ. May it be him that is seen today, and we'll thank you for what you do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The story is told of a tour group that was visiting Westminster Abbey in London, England. Westminster Abbey is the most famous church in all of England. It's an enormous palace of a place there in London. I think we've got a picture of it here in the slides. Do we, guys? Do you see anything in there about that? If not, don't worry about it. We'll move on. But it's the most famous church in England, and this tour group is being guided their way through Westminster Abbey. And as the guide is taking them through this church building, he's pointing out all of these different artifacts that are in there, these statues of famous leaders of England and famous paintings of all these important moments in history, and the throne on which England's monarchs are crowned there in the middle of Westminster Abbey. And then they go to the poet's corner, the musician's corner, and all of the great people of the past that have their own corner there at Westminster Abbey. And as they pause there at the end of the tour group and ask for questions, the tour guide says, "Are there any questions here today?" And one of the people pipes up and he says, "Boy, this is a beautiful place, enormous and beautiful artifacts and beautiful buildings. And this is a wonderful church building." But he says, "I have a question. Has anybody been saved here recently?" And you know what he was saying? He's saying, "Perhaps we have missed the point of why there is a church building to begin with. Church buildings are not to be museums of the past. They are not to be places of ornate decoration just for the sake of ornate decoration. They are meant to be places where people are brought to an understanding of who Jesus is. The church and the building that houses the church itself is to be a place that points people to Jesus Christ. It is to be a place that spreads the gospel, that spreads the gospel. We must remember the purpose of our ministry." You know, it's just my opinion, but I think it's true that if you go to a lot of churches where there has been a museum erected, so to speak, where all that is discussed is the past and all the wonderful things that have happened in the past, and all that is done is all the money is spent to beautify the property, and that's all that anybody is focusing on there at that church, I have found that many times those are the most contentious churches that you'll ever walk through. Because when we're not focused on the success of what makes Jesus happy, what puts a smile on Jesus' face, when we're not about the mission that Jesus has given us to fulfill, then we get bored. We get bored. When people aren't getting saved, when we're not working and laboring together as a unit to bring people to Christ, and we're not reaching out, then we get bored. And you know what bored people do? They fight. Bored people fight, they argue, they look for something to get fired up about, and if we're not fired up about the gospel, then we're going to get fired up about something. And many times those churches become places of contention and argumentative spirits, and it becomes a difficult place to even be anymore because the purpose has been lost. For all the beauty, for all the splendor, for all of the blessed past that should be celebrated. By the way, I'm not against celebrating. May 20th this year, we're going to have our 15th anniversary service, and we're going to celebrate the good things that God has done here. But when that becomes the driving purpose of the church has missed its purpose. The church has missed its purpose. So I want us to think this morning as we close out this series of messages, let's think about what Jesus said. He said, I chose you and ordained you that you should do what? That you should bring forth fruit. Bring forth fruit. And fruit that remains. Eternal fruit. Everlasting fruit. Fruit that continues through all of eternity. And so as we work our way through these verses here this morning, think about this with me first of all, the call to Christian service. The call to Christian service. Here in verse number 16, Jesus speaks to his disciples, these followers of his. And these disciples, now that Judas is gone, now that Judas has been separated from the group and he has been outed as a traitor, and he is, now that he's gone, these 11 disciples that remain are eventually going to become the apostles of Christ. All right? So what's the difference between a disciple and an apostle? The word disciple means a follower, a trainee, if you will. The word disciple, the root word of that comes from the word that we call discipline. Discipline. All right? So they are being disciplined, not in the corporal sense or the punishment sense, but they're learning disciplines of the faith. They're following Christ and learning to walk as he walked, following him, being taught and trained by him. And then in Acts chapter 1, we see them called no longer disciples, but apostles. Apostles. And by the way, we're all, if you're saved and born again, we're all disciples of Christ. We're all in the training program that God has set up for us. And your training program may look a little bit different than my training program, but all of us are disciples. We are followers of Jesus Christ. But the question is, are we going to make the transition from disciple to apostle? Disciple to apostle. You see, disciple means one who is under training. Apostle means one who is sent forth on a mission. One who is sent forth on a mission. And so these disciples trained for 3 years with Jesus to learn his heart, to learn his character, to become like him so that they could be more effective when he transitioned them to become apostles. And they were sent out on the mission that God had for them. And so, again, everyone here today is a disciple. If you're a believer in Jesus Christ. By the way, if you're not a believer in Jesus Christ, we need to get that taken care of today. Not tomorrow, not next week, not 3 years from now. Let's deal with it now. Become a disciple of Jesus Christ. But not every disciple is an apostle. God would have us to be so. God would like to see us work our way there and get to that place. And by the way, the Bible says in Romans chapter 9 that every born-again believer is predestined to be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ, meaning that it is in God's plan to make you like Jesus. And all of us will become like Jesus one day, whether it's here on this earth or we're eventually going to become just like Jesus in heaven. The Bible tells us that in 1 John chapter 3. We're all going to be conformed to his image someday, and there's a lot to that. We're not going to get into all that this morning, but settle it in your mind this morning that it is God's plan for you and for me and for our church to become more like Jesus, to become more like Jesus. The measuring stick of our effectiveness as a church and as Christians has nothing to do with the number of people that are sitting in the room. It has something to do, I shouldn't say nothing, it has something to do with that, but that's not the most important measuring stick. It's not how big the offerings are, and I'm grateful for people that give and that give faithfully, but that's not the measuring stick of our effectiveness. It's not the number of salvations and baptisms and things like that, those measurable things, those tangible things are important, but they are not the real measuring stick of our effectiveness. The measuring stick of our effectiveness that we need to be looking for is how close are we to Jesus Christ? The measuring stick of the effectiveness of every church is, are we like Christ? Because if we're not like Christ, it doesn't matter how many people are in the building. It doesn't matter how many salvations we think we have or how many times we've stirred the baptismal waters or how big the offerings are. If we are not like Christ, we have missed our purpose. We've missed our purpose. We are called to be disciples. We are called to be disciples so that we can eventually train ourselves and learn of him and grow in Christ to become apostles for Christ. Apostles for Christ. And you say, wait a minute, preacher, are you saying that every one of us is supposed to be an apostle? Well, I think we see through the book of Acts that the office of apostleship is over and done with. The office of an apostle is finished. Go to Acts chapter 1. I want to show you that this morning. Acts chapter 1. Just a couple of pages over there. Acts chapter 1 in verse number 1. Acts chapter 1, verse 1. This is the disciple, Luke, writing here, the physician. And as Luke is writing here, he's going to lay out for us what it means to be literally an apostle. All right? Acts chapter 1, in verse number 1. He says, "The former treatise have I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began both to do and teach." So he's talking here about the gospel record of Luke. He says, the treatise, the work, the book, that I wrote for you already of everything that Jesus began both to do and to teach. He's talking about the gospel record of Luke. He says, I wrote you that record, and I wrote about the life of Jesus, verse number 2, until the day in which he was taken up. He says, that's where the story stops. We didn't get there in the gospel record of Luke, but now he says, I'm going to pick up the pen, and I'm going to start writing again to tell you the rest of the story. What happened after Jesus left this earth? Verse number 2, he says, until the day in which he was taken up, after that he, through the Holy Ghost, had given commandments unto the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. So Luke introduces us to this new office that we call apostleship. And he tells us the three qualifications for an apostle. How do you get to be an apostle? Well, there's three qualifications. And we're going to start here in verse number 2 and look at them, all right? He says, the apostles whom he had chosen. All right? They have to be directly chosen for the office by Jesus Christ himself, all right? That's qualification number 1. Anybody else disqualified at this point? I know that never happened to me. So I'm disqualified at that point. All right, verse number 3, he says, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion. So his passion is his death and his resurrection. So he says, these are also men who've been chosen by Christ for this office, but they've also witnessed the resurrected Jesus Christ with their very own eyes. All right, I know I'm out at that point. All right, and I know you are too, okay? Maybe Oral Roberts was still in at this point, but everybody else, we're gone. We're done at that point, right? And then he finishes it off in verse number 3 and tells us the third qualification. Being seen of them 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. So they had to be chosen, they had to see the resurrected Christ with their own eyes, and they had to be personally trained by Jesus Christ for this work. That 40 days of speaking of the kingdom of God, he's training them, all right? So those are the three qualifications. All of us are out at that point, okay? We're all done. Nobody in this room can legitimately say, nobody in this world today can legitimately say that they are an apostle of Jesus Christ. But even though the office of apostleship is done and over, the work of apostleship continues. The work of apostleship goes on. Even though the office is done, the work continues to this day. How does that work continue? All right. The word apostle in the Greek language means is apostelos. All right. It means one who is sent forth on a mission, right? There, that is a Greek word that continues on into that. We don't use anymore, right? I mean, we don't speak in Greek anymore. And after about the 3rd or 4th century, nobody spoke in that kind of Greek anymore anyways, Koine Greek. Everything transitioned to Latin. That became the language of the day. And so then we stopped talking about apostles, and the word apostle kind of fell out of usage, and it transitioned to the word missionary. Missionary. Apostles are our apostles held the office that current day missionaries have continued. Missionaris in the Latin means one who is sent forth on a mission. So we're talking about the same work being continued in our world today, in our very churches today. We are seeing this Christian service of apostleship continuing. All right, so let's talk about number two, something else. We've talked about the call to Christian service. Let's talk about the reminder to produce. The reminder to produce. Jesus tells us here in John 15 and verse number 16 that we have been ordained to bring forth fruit. To bring forth fruit. All right, we talked about fruit several weeks ago. So what are the fruit? Week 7 of the series, we talked about that. What are the fruit? Let's just recap them real quick here. All right, first of all, there's the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit. And then there's the resentment of the reality of sin within each and every one of us. There's the fruit of worship. There's giving. That is a gift or a fruit that God produces in us. There is communication that blesses people's hearts and encourages others. There is godly behavior. And remember the seventh fruit that we talked about, the fruit of souls. The fruit of souls. Jesus says, I want you to bring forth fruit, and it needs to be fruit that remains. What is the most everlasting and eternal thing that you and I can produce for Jesus Christ? Souls. Bringing souls to Jesus Christ. Bringing people to the Lord. How can we produce souls that are one to Christ? All right. Well, first of all, as individuals, we have a responsibility to speak the gospel to those who are lost. We have a responsibility to speak to the gospel to others that we come in contact with, that God gives us an opportunity to share the gospel with. We need to take that opportunity and share the gospel with them. And as a church, we talked about individuals, but as a church, we are a collection of vine branches who have voluntarily joined ourselves together to carry out God's mission in this world. We are here to accomplish God's work in this world and to carry out his orders. We are an army. Paul uses that vernacular. He uses that picture in his writings, the Apostle Paul does. And we are to carry out Christ's orders. And the most prominent of his orders is the Great Commission. The Great Commission. Let's talk about that number three there. That's our third thought this morning, the Great Commission. Let's talk about that for just a second. What is the Great Commission? Where do we find that in the Bible? Is it even a scriptural idea? All right, well, I want you to go with me through the Bible this morning. I'm going to show you the Great Commission broken up into five parts. All right, Matthew 28 is our first place to go. Matthew 28, verse number 19. Go there with me if you would. Matthew 28, verse number 19. Matthew 28, verse number 19. Bible says here, Matthew 28, verse 19, go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you, and lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. So Jesus tells us here in this first part of the Great Commission that we are to go make disciples and plant churches for him. That's the work that he's talking about here when he says, win them to Christ, baptize them, and teach them. He's talking about a church. That's an ecclesia, a body of believers. So we are called to go make disciples for him. Mark chapter 16, verse 15. Mark chapter 16, verse 15. Go there with me. All right, Mark 16, verse 15. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Does it get any clearer than that? I mean, could he have said it any plainer than that? Go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Preach the gospel in every corner of the world. That means that there is no one that is not a candidate to hear the gospel. There is not one person that you come across that doesn't need to hear the gospel. And you say, well, what if they're already saved? I mean, that person goes to church. I think they're a good person. Well, wait a minute. I've been a believer for a lot of years now. I hate to even count now. But I've been saved for, I think, 25 years now. You know what? I still love to hear the gospel. I still love to hear the gospel. And can I tell you this? I've had maybe two encounters in my life, in my entire life, where somebody, a stranger, has walked up to me, or even a friend has walked up to me and said, Brian, do you know for sure that you go to heaven when you die? You know what? We need to be sharing the gospel. There's nobody that isn't a good candidate to hear the gospel. Luke 24, verse 46. Go there with me. Luke 24, verse 46. Luke 24, verse 46. This is Jesus speaking again. It says, and he said unto them, thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And ye are witnesses of these things. Ye are witnesses of these things. So Jesus tells us here that it's not only something that we just teach, we instruct people about, but we ourselves must be personal witnesses of the gospel. We have to be partakers of the gospel before we are to share it. If you have been born again, if you've been saved, you know what Jesus has done in your life. You know the price that he paid for your sins, and you have witnessed with your own eyes the difference that Jesus has made in your life. And he says, go tell people about it. Go tell people about it. Go tell people your story about how you came to know Jesus. Tell people what life was like before you came to Jesus. Tell people how you came to Jesus. And tell people the difference that he has made ever since that day. All right, and then John chapter 20 and verse number 21. John chapter 20, verse number 21. Go there with me. John chapter 20, verse 21. By the way, I've noticed noses up in the air this morning, and I don't think you're being snobbish here today. I know that there's an odd smell in the room here. We've got some guys investigating it, make sure there's nothing to be worried about. And so if there's any reason of concern, then we'll take care of it, all right? But don't worry about it, all right? Don't worry about it. We're good. We're safe, all right? But let's just focus back in here on the message, and we've got guys checking it out for us, okay? John chapter, maybe it's just me. Is it just me? Okay. I was about to say, this suit is clean. I know I'm good, so. All right, but yep, we're figuring it out. We're checking it out. That's right. John chapter 20, verse 21. Let's read this together. John chapter 20, verse 21. It says, then said Jesus to them again, peace be unto you. As my Father hath sent me, even so send I you. You know what Jesus is saying there? He's saying, God the Father sent me on a mission, and I am now sending you on that same mission. We are on a mission. This is not, what's that old song, Brother Marty? This is a battlefield, brother, not a recreation room. This is a real deal. This is the mission that God has given us in this world. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. We'll look at this as our last part of this idea of the Great Commission. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. The Bible says here, but ye shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon you. And ye shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and unto the uttermost part of the earth. So he says, we're to be witnesses for Jesus Christ. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. And it's only going to happen. Our effectiveness as laborers for Christ, as servants for him, our missionaries that we send out of our churches, that we support financially, that we support through prayer, it's only going to work in God's power. It's only going to work and be effective if God blesses it. And God gets behind it. It's not about us. It's not about our programs. It's not about how good we are and how effective we are. Now, we want to be effective, and we want to know what we're doing, and we want to make sure we're doing things well and doing it right. But we can have all those T's crossed and all those I's dotted, but if God doesn't get into it, it's not going to work. It's not going to be effective. It's not going to be useful for him. So, if we're supposed to go, if Midway Baptist Church is supposed to touch the world with the gospel of Jesus Christ, if we have been called to partake in this great commission to reach the world, to speak the gospel to every creature, how in the world are we going to do that from here in Unionville, Missouri? How do we accomplish the Great Commission? We do it through what we call world missions. World missions. We are partaking in the work of mission. So let's talk about this fourth point here this morning, the challenge of missions. The challenge of missions. We've been challenged to reach the world. How do we do it? We do it through what we call missions and missionaries. This mission is very important. It is vital. I told you last week I don't want to stand before God someday and have him look at me and I say, God, I got all the T's crossed and all the I's dotted. I gave all of those infidels trouble, all those people who don't believe the same way that I do. I called them out from the pulpit, all those preachers that I don't like. I blasted them. And the Lord look at me and say, but you missed the whole point. You missed the whole point. You didn't accomplish the mission that I gave you to accomplish. Sure, you did that, but you wasted all of your time. You wasted all of your resources. You wasted all your precious energy. You missed out on the mission. This mission is important. Back in John chapter 15, in verse number 18, Jesus tells us that this is not going to be easy. This work that he's given us to do is not going to be easy. He says in verse number 18, if the world hates you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. Let me ask you a question. Did Jesus suffer from some adversity during his time on this earth? Absolutely. Were there people who opposed him and opposed his work that he tried to accomplish? Absolutely. In fact, they nailed him to a cross for it. Jesus suffered all kinds of adversity, and he says, if I suffered adversity, don't be surprised when you suffer adversity. Don't be surprised when you have difficulties as you try to accomplish this mission that God has given to you. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verse 9, the Apostle Paul says it this way, a great door and effectual is opened unto me. He says there is a great opportunity out there, and there are many adversaries. And there are many adversaries. With every open door that we have to reach more people for Christ, the devil is waiting on the other side of that door. They say that the door of opportunity swings on the hinges of adversity. There's a lot of truth to that. When we try to claim new ground, when we try to do new things for Christ, when we try to accept the challenge that God has given to us as believers and as a church, we're going to face some troubles. It's not going to be easy, but it is worth it. It is worth it. The Apostle Paul said, I have fought a good fight. I have fought a good fight. And when he said that, he wasn't saying that I did a great job. He wasn't saying I was out there knocking heads and I did an awesome job and I did it. I fought a good fight. No, he means it's a good fight to be in. It is a worthwhile way to spend your life. It is a good fight to be in. Parents, can I encourage you, if God is speaking to the hearts of your young people to serve him and live for him, please don't discourage them. Please don't discourage them. Please don't stand between them and God's working in their heart and say, well, you'll never make any money at it. It's going to be trouble. People aren't going to like you. It's going to be a challenge. Please don't do that. It is a good fight to be in. It is a worthwhile way for them to spend their lives. And parents, it's a worthwhile way for you to spend your life too. If God is speaking to your heart, don't say no. Say, well, why not? Ask Jonah. Ask Jonah. He'll tell you why you should never say no to God. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 5. I want you to look at this with me. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 5. The Bible says here, for when we were coming to Macedonia, our flesh had no rest. We were troubled on every side. Without were fightings, within were fears. So this is the Apostle Paul talking. He says, when we came to Macedonia and we were going to start this new work in Macedonia, we had nothing but trouble. There was an open door, and there were the adversaries. He says, it wasn't easy. Without were fightings, within were fears. And every time you and I try to take on some new territory for God, whether it's in our own personal lives, in our homes, and even to try to increase our opportunities to win people for Christ, to speak to people about Christ, or as a church, as we're trying to reach people for the Lord. We're going to face these two struggles, fightings from without and fears from within. All right, let me give you some examples of this. As a church, as the Christian world, this is the kind of fightings from without that people are facing. We are losing access to the lost. We are losing access to the lost. 86 countries in this world prohibit or restrict Western missionaries, meaning that missionaries are not allowed in the country whatsoever. 60% of unreached people groups live in countries that are closed to missionaries from North America. 60% of people that need the gospel can't get the gospel because those doors are closed. Over 160,000 believers in these countries, these closed countries, over 160,000 of them will be martyred this year, put to death for their faith in Christ. And 67% of all humans from AD 30, when Jesus ascended back to heaven around that time, 67% of all humans from that time to the present day have never even heard the name of Jesus Christ. 67%. Despite the fact that Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, almost three quarters of them have never even heard his name. Around 30 million people this year will die without hearing about Jesus. 70,000 people die every day in the unreached world without ever hearing the name of Jesus Christ. There are fightings from without. The devil is trying to keep the gospel away from people. These closed doors, these closed opportunities mean that the devil is ramping up his assault. He knows his time is short, so he's ramping up his assault to keep the gospel away from people that need to hear it. Fightings from without, but the Apostle Paul says that with those fightings, there's also fears. Fears from within. We're losing access, but I think we're also afraid of losing our creature comforts. Losing our creature comforts. Listen to this. North American and European Christians spend $12.5 trillion on themselves and their families each year. The total cost of Christian outreach averages $330,000 for each and every newly baptized person, meaning that for every person that gets saved and baptized, the church has spent $330,000 to reach them. Now, I'm not saying that we shouldn't do that. Every soul is worth that and more. But it shows that we're not being very effective. We're not being very efficient in what we're doing. Listen to this. Church embezzlements exceed the entire cost of all foreign missions worldwide, meaning that there's more money being skimmed off the top by dishonest brokers and churches than what we're actually sending out into the world of missions. That's a heartbreaking thought, isn't it? We're wasting and stealing more money than we're investing in the souls of men. It's a scary thought. We're going to give account to God for that someday, by the way. The average American Christian gives only one penny a day to global missions. One penny a day to global missions. Look, numbers don't lie. Numbers don't lie. And the story that these numbers tell us is that we have allowed the intimidation of Satan to squelch the missionary fervor that we have, and we have allowed our creature comforts to deplete our missionary fervor in the first place. There are fightings from without, and from within their fears. And it makes missions a challenging thing. It makes it a difficult thing. There was a one-legged school teacher from Scotland who came to a man by the name of Hudson Taylor. Hudson Taylor really was the innovative mind that launched missions into China and got missionaries into the country of China. And he was interviewing potential prospective missionaries to go to China, and a one-legged school teacher comes walking in the room. He sits down with Hudson Taylor, and you got to remember, this is in the 1800s, when that was a little bit more of a hampering effect than it is today, to only have one leg. And Hudson Taylor said this: with only one leg, why do you think of going as a missionary? George Scott, this one-legged school teacher, said, because I don't see those with two legs going. Know what he's saying? He's saying the people that are able and will, that are able and ready to go, they're not going. So I'll go. Here am I, Lord. Send me. God, if you have to rely on somebody like me, it's a sad state of affairs, but God, I'll go. I'll do it. I'll do what you need done around this world. I will be your emissary. And I tell you what, I want to dig this thought deep into the hearts of our young people. And so that's why this summer we're going to be taking this missions trip to the Navajo Reservation down there in New Mexico. And I wanted to share with you today our parents that are here that so that you can be praying and thinking about this, and then also those who are going to be here, how we can pray more effectively for them. I want you to watch this video here. It's a long video. I'll just go ahead and tell you. It's about a 10-minute video. And the pastor that's featured in it, he's a little different than us, all right? He thinks things a little bit differently than I do. He says things a little bit differently than I do. But he's serving God and trying to win souls. He's a little bit more of a hard-nosed fellow than I might be. But you know what? He loves God. He's trying to win souls to Christ in a part of the world, that in a part of our country that's very difficult to do so. And so we're going to go and we're going to help. We're going to go and be a part of that and propel that ministry forward. So I want you to see this video. Guys, you got that queued up there?
Do you see what the land looks like? This is the Indian Nation. I want you to picture that it's 1850. In 1850 was this road here. In 1850 was this town of Shiprock there. Was the city of Farmington there? No. The nearest town was that way, about 300 miles, called Santa Fe, New Mexico. We're putting the Indians out here. Supposedly hunting, fishing, farmland. You see the land. It's 1850. Nearest town is Santa Fe, 300 miles away. You have no horse and wagon. There's no roads. There's no towns. There's no water to drink. This land is what he calls sandstone. A pickaxe wouldn't break it up. So you couldn't farm it. If you could have all the water in the world, it wouldn't grow anything because it's sandstone. But suppose it was perfect ground, good, rich, black ground. It never rains here, so what could you grow? Next question is, it's 1850. The nearest town is Santa Fe, New Mexico, 300 miles away. Why do you really think we put them out here?
To die.
To die.
Born and raised in Florida, went through the Marine Corps, went through Vietnam, came home a lost man, and August 24th, 1970, the Lord saved me. 8 months later, just a very short time, God called me to preach. He didn't call me to pastor. A novice is not supposed to pastor, but he called me to preach, and I did like Jonah. I ran from him. I didn't want to do it. Then I got convicted just to give my life to God, and I went off to a Christian college, and in 1975, God called me to be a missionary to Navajo Indians. So I've been here as a missionary since 1975. we would go soul winning. I would run Sunday school, Sunday mornings, Sunday nights, Wednesday nights, Thursday night soul winning, Saturday bus calls, as if I was running 1,000 people. And for years, no one came. I preached to my wife and 2 boys for all those years. And then one Wednesday night, I came from work to preach to my wife and 2 boys, and 79 people showed up. And I was able to see those people saved. And 6 months later, was running 250 and been growing ever since. There's roughly 500,000 living in an area the size of South Carolina. It covers the parts of 4 states, largest Indian reservation in the world. It's hard for me to explain to you because I love them. You know, God's given me a love for the people that he's called me to minister to. They're self-sustaining in a way because they were put out here in 1850 with a treaty. Many believe they're put out in the desert to die. Their living conditions is way below what you and I would expect from the very poor in the other areas of the United States. Very below normal living, very high unemployment. Those who have money either live in a government-type housing or they live in a mobile home. Substandard, you still got people living in hogans. You got still people living, no running water, no electricity right here in America. We have a church here for them. We have a Bible Institute. We have a Christian school, 4-year kindergarten, 12th grade school. In the last 20 plus years, we've never had a week where we didn't have a visitor or someone saved. So God is really blessed to put his hand on our ministry. There's 3 things you need to do. Number one, you need to take a stand. And I don't mean just occasionally say I'll agree, but a man needs to take a strong stand on the King James Bible, number one. And that's not going to be very popular in the day and age you live in. Number two, you need to do something to keep somebody from going to hell every week of your life. Then number three, whatever God does, you need to make sure he gets all the honor and glory for it. So because it was God that did it, it was not me. I mean, I can't go get 25 people to get in a van and come to church, but God can bring them in.
The bus ministry is a huge part of our church. Without it, we would drop in half. We'd be cut in half easily, if not more, because the bus ministry goes out and gets them when they can't come in on their own. At the current time, we have a bus that goes about 50 miles in one kind of direction. It comes back a different direction. So round trip on a Sunday, you're looking at 100 miles. I have people on my bus route. I'll go out and knock on doors, and people have never even heard of Jesus Christ, don't know that he died on the cross, have no idea what the Bible says. Just totally different upbringing, totally different atmosphere. And the circumstances that surround their lives are you got to start at Genesis. I mean, you start at the ground floor and work your way up. It's a nation within a nation. If we were to take you and blindfold you and drop you off in the middle of the res, they speak a different language, they have different color skin, they have a totally different philosophy of life. You wouldn't think you were in America. We have so many needs, of course, our Christian school, we have to limit it. We have to put a waiting list out because we don't have enough teachers. Our bus ministry, we've got buses, we just don't have enough bus workers. We've got the people that are out there that need to be reached. We just need the help.
There is a place in America where people have a different skin color, who speak a different language, who are forgotten about. We pray daily for help, labors for the harvest.
Dad's my hero. Dad's a hero of course our country for military service that he didn't bid on. Purple Hearts, Bronze Star, the works. I mean, the medals are on the walls. But he's a hero of the faith as well. He started this work from nothing, with nothing, and didn't ever go on deputation, didn't raise any support, didn't know what to do or how to do it. Just felt like, you know, the Navajo people were dying and going to hell and needed to get here as soon as possible.
I didn't use the relics. I didn't use the Indian people for gain. I didn't use them and look at them as a novelty. I started looking at them as a soul going to heaven or hell. It totally changed my ministry.
God could have done it, used anyone, but God chose him. And God chose him for a reason, because he was able to get the job done. He stuck it out for all these years, and decades later, God's blessed, and now we have all of the things that we have now. But I remember no water, no electricity. I remember no church building. I remember all the things that we went through with the difficulties.
My eye affected my heart. We plead with pastors. We plead with churches to take mission trips, to come out here and take a look. You know, we want that for many reasons, because the main one is your eye does affect your heart. There's so many fables, so many stories about Indian casinos and the richness and the wealth of the Indians. And nobody ever gave us land, but we gave these Indians hunting, fishing, and farmland. But if you go out and see it, you see it's just desert. It's there's nothing there. There's no water to where you could live. There's no animals to hunt. It's just a barren desert land. I make a joke about it, tell them the only thing it ever grow is old. But that's sad because it's a true fact. If a missionary comes to your church, it sounds like a missionary story, but when you come and see for yourself the reality of this so-called honey fishing farmland we gave them is really just desert, good for nothing. That's why many think they were put out there to die. If nothing comes in, I'm still going to serve God and keep winning souls and keep building the church and building my people.
Time and money can solve a lot of things, but people who are just willing to say, I'm willing to go and I'm willing to serve, and for God to speak to somebody's heart and say, this is something that God wants me to do and I'm willing to do it.
So that's where we're going this summer. We're going to go help that man and his church. There's a need there. As he talked about, the bus ministry is a huge part of what they do. When you have people who don't have running water and they don't have electricity, they also don't have vehicles. And so for them to come in to church, somebody's got to go get them. And so the bus ministry is a big part of what they do there, busing out to go get them and bring them in. And so we're going to go help them expand those bus routes. We're going to go find new people to get onto those bus routes for them, and lots of door-to-door work and things like that. And it'll be a great opportunity for these young people to learn how to invite people to church, how to tell people about Jesus Christ. And so we're going to be there from June 22nd. We're going to leave June 22nd through June 28th. June 22nd through June 28th. And by the way, this we've been talking about this as a trip for our teenagers, but I also want to encourage you adults. If you would like to go, you're a member of Midway Baptist Church, and you would like to go, come talk to me. Come talk to me. We're actually looking for a set of adult chaperones to go on this trip and to be there with the kids and to sponsor that. And if you're a chaperone, we're going to take care of you. We're going to make sure that that's taken care of for you. And it'd be a great opportunity for you to go and see a mission field right within our own country. A place that we would don't give a lot of thought to in our daily lives. But there they are, a nation within a nation. And we're going to go be a part for just a short time. But we're going to go and try to make an impact for the gospel of Jesus Christ while we're there. And so as we close out this morning, I just want you to think about this. We think about this idea of missions, this idea of producing the fruit of souls for Jesus Christ. It's intimidating, isn't it? It's intimidating. There's no doubt about it. How in the world do we accomplish such a big and broad mission? But if it was, if it's intimidating to us today with Facebook and intercontinental travel and all the things that we have today, if it's intimidating to us, imagine how much more intimidating it was to the apostles when Jesus gave it to them. Without all of the innovations and the technology and the abilities that we have today, imagine how intimidating it was to them. But they got it done. They spread the gospel around the whole world that they could touch. How did they do it? They took it seriously. They took it seriously. It wasn't just something that they were doing in their churches. It was what they did. Missions is not a program of the church. It is the purpose of the church. Missions around this world. Missions in our own backyard. Missions in our next door neighbor. All of that is our purpose as a church. They took it seriously, and they took it personally. They took it personally. There's a story told of some missionaries who were called Moravians from Europe, and they were sent out to go to the Caribbean and to reach people in the Caribbean world. And after they were sent out, the two traveled to Copenhagen, Denmark, where they were going to go from there, the port there, and travel to the Caribbean islands and win people to Christ. And they were met with strong opposition. So they met with an official there in Copenhagen and tried to enslave themselves. because slaves were freely being passed to the Caribbean at that point. They were, the slave trade was still in force, and so they tried to sell themselves into slavery so that they would be sent to the Caribbean. They were told, you can't do that. No white man will ever work as a slave. And they said, we're willing and available to do so. This passion to get to the field touched the heart of the Danish queen and her court, and they chartered these two missionaries to go and be missionaries in the Caribbean. They left in 1732 and arrived in St. Thomas 2 months later. They preached to the slaves and enjoyed some success. And by 1734, they both returned to Germany and sent other Moravian missionaries to continue the work for 50 years afterwards. They established churches on St. Thomas, St. Croix, St. John's, Jamaica, Antigua, Barbados, and St. Kitts. And when other missionaries from other denominations arrived, they had found that these Moravian missionaries who were willing to put it all on the line, who were willing to sacrifice personally to get there, they found that these missionaries had baptized 13,000 converts before any other missionaries arrived. You know how they did that? They took it seriously and they took it personally. And my question this morning is, are we willing to do the same? Are we willing to do the same? I'm not saying that it's time for us to get a busload and go to Kansas City tonight and fly out to China. I'm not saying that. But I'm saying if God spoke to your heart today and told you to do it, would you be willing? Would you be willing? God's not going to send every person here this morning to the mission field, but he wants to know, if he did call you, would you be ready? Would you be ready? Let's pray together. Lord, we love you. We thank you for this day. I thank you for your word. Lord, I'm convicted this morning as I preach this message because, Lord, we're all too, sometimes too comfortable. Many times we're trapped in our creature comforts, this bubble wrap that we put around our lives. And Lord, it protects us from the dangers that are around us, but Lord, it also sometimes prevents you from getting to our hearts. Lord, I pray that we would be willing to lay it all on the line if that's what you would have for us, that we'd be willing to give it all for the cause of Jesus Christ. God, I pray that you'd help us now in this time of invitation and speak to our hearts. For it's in the name of the Lord Jesus we ask these things. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed this morning, if you're here today and you say, Pastor Brian, if I were to die right now, I know beyond the shadow of a doubt that I would go to heaven. I know that I'll see Jesus someday in heaven. If that's your testimony this morning, would you just slip your hand up there as a praise to God? Amen. Thank you. Thank you. You can put your hands down. If you were unable to say yes to that, can I tell you this? God wants you to know. God has told us how we can know in his word. And we'd love to take the Bible today and show you how to know you're on your way to heaven. Maybe you're here today and you say, Pastor Brian, I know I'm saved. I know I'm on my way to heaven, but God spoke to me today through this message. God spoke to my heart and is dealing with me. Maybe it's not to become a missionary in the far-flung corners of the world. Maybe it's just to be a missionary to your cubicle mate at work. Maybe it's to be a missionary to your next-door neighbor. Maybe it's to be a missionary to that family member that you've been praying for. God has spoken to your heart in some way this morning. You say, Pastor Brian, pray for me. If that's you this morning, I just want to pray for you. Just slip your hand up there. Just I want to see who we're praying for today. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. Amen. Hands around the room. Can we stand together? We're going to sing together a hymn of invitation, and this is a time of decision for us. If God has spoken to your heart, I'd invite you to come to the altar. I'll be down front if you need somebody to speak with or pray with about something. But Brother Marty's going to come and lead us in hymn 369. And as he leads us in this song of invitation, Living for Jesus, if God has spoken to your heart, would you come? Thank you. And let's take out our prayer, or I keep saying that, our bulletins, our weekly bulletins there for just a second. I want to point out a couple of upcoming events to you. And we'll prepare for our to give our tithes and offerings here in just a minute. But I want to point out a couple of things to you. First of all, Sunday, April 29th. Is the original time for our Purely Praise Sunday. That's next Sunday, but with my wife being out, not being able to practice today, we're going to push that back 1 week to the first weekend of May, okay? So Purely Praise Sunday will not be the 29th. It'll be the first week of May, first Sunday in May, okay? But we're going to have some special music time during the service. We've got a lot of folks that are excited about this, lined up for it. I hope that the changing the time doesn't mess with your plans. We'd love to have you out for that day. And we've actually got trying to get together a men's group to sing, and we're going to practice right after the morning service. So if you can be a part of that men, if you can be a part of that men's group, we're going to sing, what was it? When the Roll is Called Up Yonder, that's right. If you can be a part of that, just meet Marty right down front here after the service this morning, after we say amen. Just going to run through it a couple times real quick and get that practiced up. But I like it when men sing. I like it when men praise, all right? I love it when ladies sing. They've got such a beautiful voice and everything. But when a man stands up and sings about his Lord, that's awesome. That's awesome. So you guys join in, be a part of that. And then we've got a ladies group as well my wife is communicating with, and just a lot of excitement about that day. I think it's going to be an awesome Sunday. So make sure that you're here for that. And if you want to be a part of it, if you've got a group, or if you want to sing a solo, or you've got a, you want to sing with your family, whatever you would like to do, come talk with me about it, and we'll get you scheduled, okay? And then Sunday, May 20th, Chelsea Valentine's wedding shower. Just keep that out in front of you, folks, as we prepare for that. Kelly, is she registered anywhere yet? Four, okay. All right, lots of options. Good, okay. Just be thinking about that. And then True Trackers is closing out in just a couple of weeks. So starting this Wednesday and then the next Wednesday, we're going to have catch-up weeks. So not catch-up, but catch-up weeks. So give the kids an opportunity to catch up on some verses they might have missed, catch up on the devotions that they might be behind on, and that way we can get them some extra awards as we close out the year. And then May 9th is going to be our Sundays on Wednesday ice cream party for the kids. So parents of kids and True Trackers, be thinking about that. How about birthdays to celebrate this week? Any birthdays to recognize? Rob? All right. Happy birthday. When was your birthday? Oh, it's coming up on Tuesday. Okay. Well, happy birthday to you. Anybody else? Langela? This Friday? All right. Well, happy birthday. Anybody else? How about anniversaries? Any anniversaries to celebrate? All right, then. Well, you two make sure you stop by the Resource Center and get a gift for yourself on behalf of the church. Happy birthday to y'all. And let's prepare to give our tithes and offerings to the Lord this morning. Let me have some men come forward and help me with these offering plates here. And we will give to the Lord here today. We've got a business meeting coming up this Wednesday. Just be thinking about that. Our quarterly business meeting, just to cover the financials and give you an update on some things that we're working on. So make sure you're here Wednesday night for that. And voting members of Midway, make sure especially you're here for that. But let's pray together for this offering here this afternoon. Brother Rob, would you please pray for us? Well, I think I pinpointed the source of the odor this morning. I changed colognes this week, so I'm pretty sure it's me. So if any of you are worried about that, maybe it was your perfume or something. Don't worry, it's me. It's me. It's all right. No, I'm just kidding. I don't know. We'll figure it out when we get done here today. I think it might be these lights, guys. We'll check that out when we're done here this morning, maybe putting out an odor. So it just smells a little bit like ozone. You know, it's good for you. It's really good for you. So, all right, let's stand and we'll pray together and we'll be dismissed here. Teen boys, yes, thank you. So for the men's group, you're going to meet right down here in the front, and teen boys are welcome to participate in that. But let's pray together, and we'll be dismissed today. Brother Doug Gilworth, would you please pray for us, sir?